Hello and welcome to our channel. Today we're going to take a look at some of the firearms used in the movie Micheal Collins. Now, of course, being an Irish channel, and this is of great interest to us. When the movie came out, everybody was quite interested to see it, and it's quite a good movie, an interesting movie. I wouldn't call it historically accurate, particularly. But it's still it's an interesting movie, and if nothing else, it would get people around the world asking questions and learning more about the fight for Irish freedom from British colonialism. Right, so let's take a little look at what we have here. Right, what we have here is a Webley revolver. These were ubiquitous throughout that struggle, basically because they were British General Service, a general issue. It's a .45 caliber revolver, extremely reliable. Delivered a lot of stopping power from a .45 caliber bullet. These were preferred. A lot of the heavier caliber pistols were preferred by particularly by the squad, Micheal Collins squad, the Dublin squad. Well, because they were available, but also because they weren't particularly good. I mean, don't get me wrong, they were very brave, quite dangerous men in their own way, but they weren't particularly good pistoliers. So heavier caliber sidearms that made a lot of large holes was going to do the job for them. So the .45 caliber Webley revolver was preferred. Also, the .45, now we see this has actually been cleared, it's checked, it's empty. The .45 caliber Colt revolver also very highly prized, in great demand with the members of the squad. If they could get their hands on them, they always liked them. Actually, members of the British Secret Service liked to use this pistol also. It was preferred by those. It's believed Winston Churchill carried one of these himself, and that he carried a broom-handled Mauser, like this one, in South Africa when he was covering the Boer War as a correspondent. He had a preference for this, but we'll get to that in a moment. But yeah, the .45 caliber Colt ACP model 1911, very, very popular. Also popular, the German, because these were captured, brought back as souvenirs or as war trophies. After World War One, 9mm Parabellum, one of the most, probably the most common pistol caliber used today in the world. I mean, it was developed 100 years ago and it's still being used. So that was something that Georg Luger got right the first time. A very, very good pistol, an excellent, some people have call it unreliable. It's extremely reliable on a range, possibly not in the trenches in the mud of World War One, but certainly on a range or in conditions like the squad we're using, perfectly serviceable. And then we're going to come to another German sidearm. This is a Mauser broom handle model of C96, which means it was went into service in 1896. Fired a 7.65mm cartridge, and that sounds quite anemic, but it was bottled down, or rather neck down cartridge from a 9mm brass case to 7.65mm, made this extremely high velocity. High velocity pistol, carried 10 rounds of ammunition, very, very reliable, very, very fast bullet, delivering a lot of kinetic energy. Again, very popular with members of the squad. They like this pistol a lot. Now we're going to move on to some of the shoulder arms used from the movie. Now what we're looking at here is a Thompson model of 1921. A few of these did manage to make their way from the United States into the hands of the IRA during the Tan War. There wasn't a lot of them, but they were used very effectively, the ones that were here. And what we're looking at here is a 50 round drum magazine, what was common. The ones that were shipped to Ireland shipped with a 100 round magazine, so that's 100 rounds of 45 caliber ammunition on tap. Right, so as I mentioned, this is with a 100 round magazine. This it's quite complex to load. You're going to load your ammunition and round into the spaces there. Put that back in, and then you got to turn this clockwise until you hear. I think it's 7 rotations until you hear a click, and then the magazine is at full tension and should feed reliably. very little training provided with these submachine guns, so guys did have to learn on the job. So they had, I felt that they were unreliable, but it's just a case that the operators just were not trained to use them properly. So they found the magazine to be unreliable, probably because they didn't wind it up enough. Now, see, this is it's unsafe. Magazine's to the back, and we can see that it is clear. There's no rounds in it, and loading was by this lever up like that, and the magazine fed from the side. Slid in from the side, and 45 caliber ACP ammunition, absolutely no slouch. Right, okay, so the British Lee Enfield rifle number 1 or Mark 3 .303 rifle. There's no way we could talk about the Irish fight for freedom and not mention this rifle. It was so prevalent, probably because it was issued to the British. So it was captured and put into service with the IRA. An excellent rifle, loved by the men it was issued to, loved by the men that used it. Not just Irish, but the British loved this rifle as well. 10 rounds of .303 ammunition. A very, very fast action. Now, check this. We are unloaded. I checked all these rifles before I started filming. I wouldn't keep a loaded rifle in the house anyway, which is. But we can see this. Extremely fast action to use, and a very, very reliable action, and a very reliable rifle. Another common rifle at that time, they would have been around, because it was the German Gewehr 98. There's plenty of them knocking around after World War One. They would have been captured or sold onto the surplus market, or so. A very, very sturdy action for an 8x57mm round. Very fast loads with we have a stripper clip guide here. Rounds are stripped in from the air, and very, very fast firing. Very deadly accurate. And in fact, this is the action that quite a substantial amount of sporting and deer hunting rifles are made on steel today. So that was a case of the Mauser brothers getting it right the first time. Alright, so and not even back then, due to the nature of any insurgency, I tend to put into service things that a regular military would consider to be obsolete. But if it can be used, put into service, and if you have the backbone to actually use it, nothing is obsolete. So these by military standards at the time would have been long obsolete. A single shot black powder rifle, this particular one is a French Gras. See, it's of course empty. Pull the trigger, pop out the round, put manual load the next round in, just set it down the shelf, put bolt forward, go, rinse and repeat. These were shipped to Ireland for the volunteers in 1914 or 1913. Sorry, I get my dates mixed up. The majority of ones that were shipped were a German model 1871 Mauser rifles there, but they weren't strictly the only ones sent. A good number of these French Gras were also sent, and Italian Vetterli, and this one we're looking at here is a Dutch Beaumont. Again, same kind of principle. Single shot black powder rifle, 11 millimeter. Sorry, the Gras would have been 11.4 millimeter, and the German Mauser 1871 again was an 11 millimeter. These put to use by Irish volunteers at the GPO and on Mount Street. We're looking at an MP18 there, used by some of the squad members. In this scene we have a Webley revolver. This is the technical assault on the car tank on Bloody Sunday in 1920. Luger there, held by one of the squad members. And back of walking between him and the target, not a great idea. Show there, Luger, and I think a 1911 in the hands of the Secret Service agent. Here we have a 1911, a Webley, and a Steyr Hahn, which is kind of an unusual choice for the movie. I'm not going to say they weren't around the place, they were quite common in World War One. That was actually an Austrian pistol. Yeah, it's quite possible they could have shown up. And a C-96 Mauser pistol, as mentioned earlier, very common with the. See, Joe Bourne there is carrying an FN model 1900, 32 caliber pistol. There was quite a lot of them around, but they weren't really favoured, but they didn't seem to be quite powerful enough. Here we have the Battle of Dublin. You're going to see all kinds of everything here. The Free State Forces, mainly Lee Enfield rifles. The IRA, you see some Thompsons there. The Peerless armoured car. As I mentioned, the Free State Forces are using the Enfields. We have a Thompson there in the left, another Lee Enfield rifle. And this I thought was unusual. A gentleman there running with a BAR, a Browning automatic rifle. I'm quite sure how that made its way there, but I'm not going to say it didn't happen. Again, the Peerless armoured car. Now we're going to see the Steyr Hahn showing up again in the hands of Harry Boland.
Where is it? There we go, starter hand. 9mm starter, a little longer than 9mm Luger. A lot of these self-loading pistols at that time would have been and okay, we're going to where the sequence here, where the very start of the movie, yeah, the surrender of the GPO. They didn't actually surrender from GPO, they surrendered from mercenaries. I said this wasn't the most historically accurate of movies, it's still enjoyable though. Now we're going to see that the rebels are carrying all kinds of everything, the black pedal rifles I mentioned earlier on. I think there was a Ross 303 rifle there as well. That young man carrying a 32 caliber FN 1900. He pumped a lot of shots into that guy. Now, kind of had to do that because it's 32 caliber. Right. And the Mauser 98 rifle showed up quite a lot as well. A very, very accurate rifle. See Joe Byrne hopping onto the Arthur Lewis. I don't know how he could use it when the operator couldn't. No, we're making movies that are not making sense. Right. And the hands of John.